Mr. Lolito.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'm Michael Lotito. I'm a shareholder at Littler.
I'm sorry for mispronouncing your name.
That's quite all right, Mr. Chairman. I'm a shareholder at Littler, and I'm here today on behalf of the International Franchise Association that has also submitted to the board written comments on this issue. I've given considerable thought to perhaps what you're thinking about, and that is what more can be said about this particular aspect of the rule that hasn't already been said. And it's occurred to me in reflecting on that, that there is a point of view that really cannot be overemphasized here today, and that is how would a new rule actually impact an employee involved in a representation case matter? I remember as a college student asking my employer one day why I could not vote in a labor board election that was taking place at the store that I was working at. My employer told me that I was ineligible to vote because I only worked during the summer. He also said that I would not hear from the union or otherwise need to participate in the process because I couldn't vote. I knew exactly where I stood. But what if that situation happened under the proposed rule? Assume for a moment we have a part-time employee working in a retail store. He approaches the assistant department manager wondering why a union representative is calling him at his home and sending him an email when that information is supposed to be confidential. The assistant manager explains that the information had to be provided because the NLRB has brand new election rules. The assistant manager also says that there'll be an election in 2 weeks. The employee might ask about the voting procedure. The assistant manager might say, "We do not know if you are or are not an eligible employee to vote, because you came to us through a temp agency." At which point the employee might ask, "Well, who decides that and when?" And the assistant manager might say, "We're really not sure." Former Acting General Counsel Leif Solomon issued Memorandum GC-12-04, which is now withdrawn, on April 26, 2012, suggesting in response to the old new rule that joint employment issues need to be decided upon before the election between two semicolons, citing a couple of cases which I've read, which I'm not sure stand for that proposition. But I certainly hope the Acting General Counsel's position was correct. But to me, the proposed rule is not clear on this point. Moreover, the Division of Advice is currently considering whether a joint employment relationship exists between a franchisor and a franchisee. The IFA, in a letter dated October 29, 2013, to Associate General Counsel Barry Kearney, vigorously reasserted that the traditional finding of separate businesses should continue. In short, the rule should make clear that issues about who is and who is not an employer must be litigated to conclusion, in my view, before an election is scheduled. Along the same lines, the board should make clear whether the status of an individual as an employee must be litigated prior to the election. The Northwestern case has already generated considerable controversy. Frankly, I think that this board would have been subjected to tremendous criticism if the student athletes voted in an election before their status as employees was even decided upon by our region. Further, under the existing processes, Northwestern can file a request for review and did so yesterday. Under any new procedure, will the request for review be permitted on an issue litigated before the election, or will that be abolished to expedite the holding of the election, even though it may be unclear as to who the employer or even the employee is? In sum, in my view, any new rule should clearly state that employer and employee status must be litigated to conclusion before the election occurs. The proposed rule may generate additional confusion. What if the employee goes to the assistant manager and asks her to attend a union meeting with him to get answers to some of these questions? The assistant manager might say, "I don't know if I can go. They haven't figured out if I'm a statutory supervisor, whatever that means, or not. I'm voting subject to challenge, and I'm not sure what that means either, because it's not clear if I'm in or out of the unit. If I go to the union meeting with you and they find out that I'm a supervisor, then I'm guilty of spying and the election might be set aside. So it's best for me not to go, even though if they find ultimately that I'm an employee, I had every right to be there." The employee and the assistant manager share a new form of community of interest. I call it legal limbo. Their status, right to vote in the election, and in the assistant manager's case, the right to attend either the union or the management meetings, may not be decided upon until after the election takes place. The ability to make an informed decision is the cornerstone of our election process. How is the part-time employee supposed to find out if he wants to support a union if he doesn't even know if the union will ultimately represent his interests? The same problem exists with the assistant manager. You're hearing an awful lot from management representatives, from union representatives, but at the end of the day, to me, this really is not about unions or management. It's really about employees. And in my view, the proposed rule does not necessarily further informed choice by those employees. Thank you very much.
Thank you.